Good morning, everyone. Can I welcome you to the 22nd meeting in 2015 of the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. No apologies have been received. Agenda item number one is declaration of interests. I would like to welcome Clare Adamson as a new member of the committee and invite her to declare any relevant interests.
No relevant interest, but I draw the attention to my declaration of interest as lodged with the Parliament.
Thank you. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank James Donlan for his very worthwhile contribution to the work of this committee over the past year. James will remain as a substitute member of the committee, so in the best rock star tradition, we may see him make a comeback on future occasions. Agenda item two is subordinate legislation to hear evidence on the draft private rented housing panel landlord Applications Scotland Regulations 2015. And can I welcome Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare. And from the Scottish Government, Denise Holmes, Senior Policy Officer, and Jackie Pantony, Principal Legal Officer. This instrument is laid under affirmative procedure, which means the Parliament must approve it before the provisions may come into force. Following this evidence session, the committee will be invited to consider a motion to approve the instrument under the next agenda item. Can I invite the Minister to make an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. And I appreciate the opportunity to give evidence on the Private Rented Housing Panel Landlord Applications Scotland Regulations 2015. The repairing standard contained in Part 1, Chapter 4 of the Housing Scotland Act 2006 covers the legal and contractual obligations of private landlords to ensure that a property meets a minimum physical standard. Despite having a statutory right of entry in relation to the repairing standard, landlords have expressed concern about difficulties they have in obtaining entry to their properties in order to carry out inspections and repairs. And this may be for a variety of reasons. For example, the tenant may repeatedly have been unavailable to grant access after making arrangements to do so, or the tenant might have refused access. Section 35 of the Private Rented Housing Scotland Act 2011, which is due to come into force on the 1st of December 2015, will enable a private landlord to apply to the Private Rented Housing Panel for assistance in exercising their legal right of entry in connection with the repairing standard. If a decision is made to assist the landlord, the panel member must liaise with the tenant and landlord to agree a date and time for the landlord to be given access. The intervention of the independent panel member is expected to result in the landlord being allowed into the property in the majority of cases without the need for legal action to enforce entry. These regulations set out the content of the applications to be made by landlords and makes further provision about the deciding of those applications. They should be considered in context of the wider package of measures introduced by the Housing Scotland Act 2014, which includes new measures to strengthen the repairing standard and broaden access to the PRHP by enabling third-party applications to enforce the repairing standard. I believe that the time is now right for implementing the provisions to help landlords to comply with their repairing standards duties, and these regulations form part of the implementation, as I said, of the wider package of measures that will all come into force on the 1st of December. Thank you.
Minister, can I invite members to ask any questions they have? Mike.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the Minister is able to tell us how many cases it's anticipated that panel members of this, you know, type that panel members may have to deal with?
We don't anticipate a large number of cases in this. I think we based it on over 100, around 100, 150 cases a year. We're not anticipating a large number. We think it's important where landlords have said that they're unable to exercise their duty that we have this provision to allow them to do so.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Adam?
On the face of it, the extra cost of this to the Scottish Government seems a bit high, something in the region of £150,000 a year. Mm-hmm. Could you explain where that extra cost is comes from. Yeah.
It's part of the wider, the costs there are the, sort of at the high side, I would have to say, in the first instance, these costs are at the very high side. But as we know, the PRHP is undergoing a lot of change at the moment to take on a lot of more duties and responsibilities. And there's crossover between that in terms of accommodation, some of the administration costs, the recruitment of staff costs. So there will transfer between some of the other functions that the panel is taking over. So it's not all exclusively for this particular section of the Housing Act, because it wouldn't, given the extension of what the panel's doing, it's not going to recruit just specifically for this regulation. So there will be crossover and transfer. Okay. And we're certainly something absolutely... I think you make a very valid point there. It's something we've set at the high side and we're keeping our eye on, and we'll be watching that all the way through.
Okay. Anyone else? Are you able to say, Minister, what mechanisms are in place to review the operation of these provisions and to make sure that they are tweaked where necessary?
Yeah. Well, we'll be constantly reviewing them in terms of the private rented housing panel. Once the applications are... start to receive applications, we'll be able to know then exactly how many applications there are, what how often applications are made for this particular regulation, whether or not it's beneficial to landlords as well. So all of that will be getting reviewed as we progress with, you know, all the clauses of the Housing Bill.
Okay, thank you. Are there any further questions? In that case, I thank the Minister and officials for their oral evidence. The third agenda item is the formal consideration of motion S4M14634, calling for the committee to recommend approval of the draft Private Rented Housing Panel Landlord Applications Scotland Regulations 2015. I invite the Minister to speak to and to move motion S4M14634.
Okay. I move that the Infrastructure and Capital Investment Committee recommends that the Private Rented Housing Panel Landlord Applications Scotland Regulations 2015 be approved.
Okay, I invite any further comments and questions from members. There are no further questions and comments. The question is that motion S4M14634 in the name of Margaret Burgess be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. That concludes the consideration of this affirmative instrument. We will report the outcome of our consideration to the Parliament. I will now allow a short suspension for a witness changeover. Thank you. resume this meeting of the committee. Agenda item 4 is the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill, where the committee will continue to receive evidence on the bill this morning from the letting agents and landlord representatives in a roundtable format. Before we commence the session, can I inform members, witnesses and those in the public gallery that they will be invited to be upstanding to observe a 2-minute silence to commemorate Remembrance Day at 11 a.m. I aim to suspend the meeting at approximately 10:58, and at 11 a.m. I will invite all of those present to observe the 2-minute silence. Following this short suspension, we will then resume the meeting and evidence session on the bill. In order to allow for a more free-flowing discussion on the bill, the committee has chosen to conduct this session in a round-table format. However, we are keen to ensure that we receive evidence on all aspects of the bill, and therefore the session will be structured around its different sections. Given the time available, it is therefore important that stakeholders seek to speak on those areas of the bill of most importance to them, and you are not obliged to contribute to each section of our discussion this morning. Members will kick off each of the sections of our discussion on the various aspects of the bill, and I will allow other witnesses to respond should they have comments, and then committee members can then be brought in if they wish to add to the discussion. I'm now going to ask all of us present for our discussion to introduce themselves, starting with myself. I'm Jim Eady, I'm the convener of the committee, and I'll move to my left.
Siobhan McMahon, MSP for Central Scotland, Labour member.
Jonathan Gordon, I represent the RICS, but not just landlords or letting agents, we represent everybody because we have a royal charter that says we have to represent the public interest.
David Stewart, I'm a Labour MSP for the Highlands Islands region.
Malcolm Warwick from Let Scotland.
Alec Johnston, Conservative member, North East Scotland.
Amanda Viviorco, Council of Letting Agents.
Katie Dixon, Scottish Land and Estates.
Mike McKenzie, MSP, I'm a SNP MSP for the Highlands and Islands region.
David Cox from the Association of Residential Letting Agents.
Clare Adamson, SNP Central Scotland member.
John Boyle, PRS for Scotland and Director of Research at Reddy & Co.
Adam Ingram, SNP MSP for Carrick, Cumnock and Doon Valley.
John Blackwood from the Scottish Association of Landlords.
Okay, thank you very much, everyone. The bill aims to improve security of tenure for tenants and provide appropriate safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. And that's set out, obviously, in the policy memorandum. In general terms, do you think the proposals in the bill achieve the appropriate balance between improving security of tenure and providing those appropriate safeguards? Who wants to lead off on that?
I'm happy to kick off. Is that okay? The simple answer is no, we don't believe it does provide adequate safeguards for private landlords. I think the important thing to emphasise is that we have no objection to greater security of tenure for tenants. Landlords are in the business of letting properties. We want tenants to stay for as long as possible in our properties. However, landlords are investors. They feel that they need the right to be able to bring those tenancies to an end if the need arises. One of the concerns we have under the current regime is the lack of security and confidence we have in the current grounds for repossession when things go wrong. Normally, tenancies are absolutely fine. Tenants act within the confines of the tenancy agreement and are happy to stay on, and good relationships are developed between landlords and tenants. That is in the main what happens in the sector. However, sometimes that's not the case, and we need adequate protections for both tenants and landlords when that happens. So a fear we have with the grounds that are proposed, we had 17 under the current legislation, 16 under the new proposals in the bill, and whilst we have lobbied for some of them to be added in, and we welcome some of those additions, we do have concerns in losing the right to bring a tenancy to a natural end at the end of the tenancy. We've got landlords and tenants entering into agreements willingly, whereby now only tenants would be allowed to bring those tenancies to an end. And we believe that will be a concern, especially with regards to antisocial behaviour in our local communities and those landlords offering student accommodation. So we feel there's going to be a shortage of student accommodation in the PRS in the future.
Okay. Who else would like to come in? Dr. Boyle.
Yeah, I mean, I'd echo John's points. We support more secure tenancies and greater flexibility in tenancies. I think John's amply illustrated the some of the issues with no fault or the end of no fault, what's called the end of no fault possession. I think the standard framework that's been proposed for the tenancy framework is not going to be flexible enough to deal with certain groups, especially the likes of students, many of whom only want 9 to 10 months leases. If the landlord's not able to set a defined tenancy period, they may regard letting to students as more risky and complicated, reducing any supply to this kind of key tenant group. Rent controls, I think, are our other main concern. I think even if they're relatively soft, i.e. with focused on rent pressurised areas where direct government permission is needed to intervene, it's likely to cause disinvestment. It's likely to be seen as the thin end of the wedge by many small and large investors. And the evidence that rents are out of control and therefore need capping, I think, is pretty flimsy.
What I said at the beginning when I introduced myself is the RICS doesn't specifically represent landlord or letting agent interests. It has a royal charter which says it must represent everybody in terms of their interests. And in that vein, I am a letting agent and work in that sector, but I'm a chartered surveyor. And just in looking at the market, there has never been any demand from tenants for longer tenancies or for complete security of tenure. What there's always been a demand for is better treatment and enforcement of the regulations that exist already. So the repairing standard is one of the best repairing standards that there is in any country that I've ever looked at. So, you know, the electrical security and gas safety and repairing standard just in terms of general items like condition of the property far exceed anything in England or anywhere else in the UK. And that's been achieved over the last few years to great success, but it's not enforced at all. So we've had one complaint, I would say, from a tenant which went to the private rented housing panel, and it's just such a long, laborious process. The tenant was actually making a complaint about things that they'd actually refused us access to fix, which was my excuse for that in front of the committee. But in the end, it wasn't a valid claim. But the length of time that took, if the tenant didn't have heating or the windows weren't being repaired and their children's rooms were mouldy and the condition of the property was poor, there was no enforcement likely or any visits to that property or anything like to happen within several months of that complaint being made to the private rented housing panel. The research that was paid for by the Scottish Government within the private sector tenancy review group that recommended a new type of tenancy found no evidence from speaking to tenants or landlords that there was any requirement for greater security of tenure.
What tenancy period? Some of the detail of the bill, just in general terms. But I wanted to get a flavour from around the table of whether people felt that the balance that the government has struck in the bill was the right one.
So, in very general terms, if you were to introduce security of tenure in the way that you have within the bill, then I believe the balance is quite a good one in terms of the rights for the tenant and the landlord. However, I don't think it's something that's required, and I think it will change the market not in a good way.
Okay, thank you for that. Mr. Warwick.
Thank you, Convener. Broadly speaking, I support what is being talked about, but the comments that have been made about the student market is demonstrative of how larger part of the market there is that is actually not being adequately catered for in what is currently being set out. The idea for longevity of tenancy is a good one, but it only really applies to about 25% of the market. And 75% of the market needs to have greater consideration in relation to its ability to have shorter and more defined terms of lease.
Okay. You wanted to come in, Mr. Cox?
As you can say, in broad terms, I'm very supportive of what has already been said. The original tenancy regime, which was created back in the 1980s, was fit for purpose for a much smaller market than exists today. Therefore, looking at this, as is also being done in Wales at the moment, and revising the tenancy framework so that it is fit for the 21st century and 21st century renting is very important. However, in general terms, we don't agree that there is the right balance at the moment. I think it is weighted in favour of the tenant over the landlord at this point in time. And we've got sort of two key aspects of the bill. One is the loss of the no-fault possession, and the other is the rent pressure zones. And we're worried that, you know, we've heard particularly about the student market already today, that there are parts of the market that, whilst the aims of the bill are very laudable, they will have unintended consequences and actually end up hurting the people that they are designed to try and help.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Ms Dixon, did you
thank you, Convener. I'd echo a lot of what has already been said. We support the new tenancy. We think a simpler system where both landlord and tenant understand their responsibilities is very much supported. However, we don't feel that the grounds offered are robust and comprehensive enough to make up for the lack of ability to end a tenant at the end of the contracted period. We echo what Jonathan said. We'd like to see more enforcement of the current regulation to ensure that high standards are achieved and that we have a professional sector.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Fiviorca?
Yes. I think as a letting agent, I think one of the main concerns we're going to be is investors coming into the market. I think that with the removal of the no-fault ground and the taking away the ability for them to take the property back, I think we're going to see a fall in investors wishing to buy, people with pensions, etc., just wishing to buy one property. I think they'll be scared of going into the market. They'll see it as higher risk, and they'll look to invest their monies elsewhere.
OK, thank you. I think all of our witnesses have contributed so far. Would any of our members like to come in? Mike, did you want to
come in? No, I'm all right for the moment.
You're okay for the moment? That's fine. Okay, I think that's a useful starting point to our discussion. Can I move on to the initial tenancy period? The bill proposes that there will be an initial tenancy period of 6 months unless the tenant and landlord have agreed on a shorter, longer initial period. But that has been criticised by some of the tenants' representative groups, for example, Homeless Action Scotland and NUS Scotland, who have told us that they do not see a need for an initial tenancy period. And Citizens Advice Scotland and the Living Rent Campaign have said that this could be a problem for some tenants, for example, where a tenant is a subject of domestic abuse and needs to leave the property quickly. Do you have a view on that? And do you have can you just, for the record, state what your position is on the initial tenancy period of 6 months? Who wants to? Ms Dixon and then Mr Cox.
We think the initial period, as it's drafted, is suitable. We think it's essential so that the landlord has certainty that there's a commitment there for the tenant for a certain period, but it also protects the tenant from certain grounds of eviction, which we think is essential as well.
Mr Cox.
Thank you very much. I would agree to a large extent on that one, but when we're looking at only the landlord, only the tenant can bring the tenancy to an end except using the ground, really what is the purpose of the minimum 6 month tenancy, particularly from the tenant's point of view? It gives a level of certainty, but a minimum tenancy would work with a no-fault possession ground. It wouldn't necessarily work as well when the grounds of possession that exist in the bill are in place and there is no-fault possession ground.
Okay. Anyone else?
Can I come in on that?
Yeah, of course, Adam.
Yeah, I just wondered, is it appropriate that a landlord or their agent can evict somebody from their home without a specific reason? You seem to be advocating that the landlord should be able to do this at will.
That's the next section.
Yes, I know, but he raised the question on the initial tenancy.
Okay. Would you like to?
No-fault possession grounds are used predominantly because they are the easiest method of regaining possession of the property. The current possession grounds take a lot longer to actually go through the courts, as Jonathan was mentioning earlier. Having the no-fault possession ground means that landlords have a degree of certainty that they will get their property back. And when we are talking about the sort of investment that we need into the private rented market to actually deliver the number of houses and the quality of the houses that we have, giving landlords the certainty that they will get their property back if they want it back is actually a very vital part of how the private rented sector has grown since the regulatory liberalisation of 1988 Housing Act.
You seem to be arguing no balance at all. Basically, all the the balance of power, as it were, is in the landlord's hands in those circumstances.
I think we need to factor in the difference between the legal framework and what is normal business practice. A landlord is not going to evict a tenant because they've had enough, they want a new tenant. The most effective way of generating rental income is having a long, well-maintained tenancy. And for a landlord, an investor, for a letting agent, that is how they are making their money, how they are keeping the property afloat, how they're paying the mortgages. Therefore, when a tenant is occupying the property in a tenant-like manner, keeping the property in a good condition, paying the rent on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis whenever it falls due, the landlord and the agent will want to keep that tenant for as long as humanly possible, because you don't know whether the next tenant is going to behave in a tenant-like manner, is going to cause antisocial behaviour, is going to damage the property, is going to pay the rent on time. And therefore, whilst we are talking about the legal framework here, we have to factor in what is common business practice. And even when we've got six-month, 12-month tenancies, if the tenant is a good tenant, the landlords and the agents will are unlikely to increase the rents at renewal stages because they want to keep that tenant, they want to incentivise that tenant to stay. Therefore, landlord possession cases only come about when there is a problem. It is not, I've had enough of this tenant, I want another tenant, because you have to factor in the actual costs involved in ending one tenancy and starting the next in terms of loss of rent. You've also got the void period to cover, letting agent fees a second time, all the marketing activities. So we are talking a considerable amount of money, and the idea of putting up a rent by maybe £10 a week will be negated if that tenant leaves, and the landlord will end up making less money because of the void periods and the tenancy changeover costs. So whilst I would argue that the current framework provides an adequate balance between landlords and tenants, we have to factor in both the legal framework and the normal business practices and market economics.
Yeah, well, as far as the initial tenancy period is concerned, I wasn't sure whether you were approve that or not.
We would support, yes, the initial tenancy period, but it would make more sense in this context with a no-fault possession ground, because otherwise, to a large extent, what is its purpose?
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Blackwood.
Convener, one issue that I think is important to remember is the Scottish Government's intention behind the bill was to grant security of tenure to tenants in the private rented sector. The initial period of tenure of let is an important part of granting that security. You will be aware that there's some grounds within the proposed bill whereby landlords cannot use those grounds within initial periods. If there wasn't an initial period, then landlords would be able to use all those grounds. Now, if we're trying to grant greater security, as well as cohesion and stability within our local communities, initial periods of let are essential in order to do that. So that's why we would advocate it's an important part of a new tenancy regime, whatever that period of tenure is. As an important point has been raised about what if you have relationship breakdowns. In the current regime, we have the ability for tenants and landlords to bring tenancies to an end by mutual agreement. And that works very well. If both parties feel it's time to move on, then that can happen. That often happens with tenants who fall out for whether in a relationship or not. They approach the landlord and say, this is no longer accommodation that's suitable to us given our circumstances. Can we agree to bring the tenancy to an end? And I think that's an important part of the tenancy regime which should be maintained and is not within the current bill. And that's why within our submission we're asking for that to be reinstated.
Anyone else on the initial tenancy period? Mr. Gordon.
I think I understand it's legally very sensible to have an initial period, otherwise it becomes a short-term tenancy for a number of people who would use it for holidays I think that would be going a step too far, but I'll come back to the stuff about when you end a tenancy without any reason, because it's not something that's evidenced that people are actually doing that. But within the six-month period, we've often allowed people to leave when they've got circumstances where they've had to go, and then we've just, if it's been straight away with it. So tenants who've moved into a property and they've had to leave, there was one actually where we took over and there was a domestic violence issue, and we dealt with their a support worker who was helping them, And we just arranged to meet them, get the keys, got the property cleaned, packed their stuff up for them, and advertised it and had it relet within a couple of weeks. So a good landlord and a good agent is the type of thing you need to encourage, and better regulation of the sector is something that will help that, but that's not part of this bill. It just needs to be enforced. Other parts of other housing bills need to be enforced better.
Did you want to come in, Mike?
No. Yes, convener, and it's slightly tangential, but just to perhaps promote a more a better discussion, because I feel a wee bit we're locked into a situation whereby so far witnesses have suggested the status quo is almost perfect and that there's therefore no need for the legislation. And I'm beginning to think I must live in a parallel universe where maybe things aren't quite so perfect, because first of all, looking at my inbox, I have I'm currently dealing with and have had over the last 4 years a great number of cases that seem to indicate to me that things are not as have been suggested here this morning. And a typical scenario is the tenant complaining about problems with fundamental things like heating systems not working in the winter, and landlords evicting them because they've had the temerity to complain about this, and that these faults have been not remedied over several months. And then sometimes in the same property you find yourself engaging with another tenant with the same problem 6 months or a year later in exactly the same property, same landlord, still not fixed the heating system. And I describe that as just one scenario, but it's typical. And if I add that to my own experiences, because living in the Highlands and Islands, I'm obliged to rent a property in Edinburgh. And if I can say to you that in my background, man and boy, I built, repaired and managed properties, and I'm absolutely appalled at the experience I find for the first time in my life being a tenant in a private rented sector, both in terms of the quality of the experience and the knowledge of the people that I've unfortunately had to deal with in this sector. So, and I'm not making any of this up. These are my, honest belief that the system is not working well, and yet what I've heard from every witness this morning suggests that it's almost perfect and this needs to be fixed. And I'll offer that, convener, really to promote what I hope can be a more honest discussion.
Thank you, Mike. Do you want to come in, Mr. Warwick, and then I'll bring in Mr. Blackwood and Mr. Gordon.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Mr. McKenzie, I think you're absolutely right. There is definite opportunity for improvement. I couldn't agree with that more. The cases that you talk about are, I'd suggest, not frequent in terms of how one looks at the overall market. It's not to say they don't exist, they do exist. And compliant landlords, compliant letting agents, we all wish to try and rid the marketplace of that kind of practice. And the reason that we're sitting here right now is because there is a large consensus amongst the marketplace to actually try and get this right so that you don't have that experience. I'm a letting agent as well. One or two of my colleagues here are letting agents. And we would all advocate that our landlord clients support us in trying to deliver good service. And I think we can do that. I have this vision that there's a bigger picture that we're all trying to strive for around this table, which will in the next 5 to 10 years' time deliver a housing market that is very, very different to that which exists today. The tenure mix might be different, the ownership structures and things like that may be different, and as a result of all of that, the kind of circumstance that you're talking about will hopefully have been driven out of the marketplace. So in looking at the kind of changes that we're doing here, it's got to be joined together. And I'm going to digress just for a moment to things like the Chancellor's changes to the tax regime for a landlord. Now, I think, generally speaking, those are a good idea. But it's got to be done in such a way that it joins up with all the other different aspects. So if I then come back to what Mr. Gordon was saying, the repairing standards have had regulations in existence for some years in order to address the kind of circumstance that you've just talked about, and which I often refer to the kind of the interaction between probably the poor landlord who owns a substandard property let to a tenant who is actually less able to look after themselves perhaps than others. That doesn't obviously apply to you. You're very able to look after yourself and still have had a poor service. So all in all, you know, what we're here today to do is to try and create something which actually addresses those. We don't think that things don't need to change. We do. But we've got to make sure that we get the joined up answers.
Indeed. Thank you.
Mr. Blackwood.
I think to reiterate some of those points, Convener, I think it's important to stress, I think all the organisations around this table would say we support a well-functioning private rented sector. That's important for us. And one of the deterrents in achieving that is bad landlord practice from landlords and letting agents too. And what we feel is we need stronger enforcement of current legislation to address exactly the issues that you're mentioning within your own constituency. It's unacceptable that landlords and letting agents flout the law, basically. That should not be the case, and action should be taken. Not only should the tenants be granted greater security and not feel they're living in fear of being evicted effectively, as you're mentioning, but those landlords shouldn't be allowed to operate. They shouldn't be allowed to let. We have existing legislation passed by this Parliament which is more than efficient in dealing with that. The issue is its implementation, not the law itself.
Do you expect your organisation to bring forward proposed amendments to achieve that or not?
Well, yes, indeed, and it's, we're looking at many ways of doing that. What we're trying to do is allow that experience to become a better experience in the private rented sector. That's in all of our interests. We want the PRS to be a housing option of choice, not of last resort. Part of that is security of tenure. We do understand that. But by taking away that no-fault ground, as we refer to it, is actually incentivising investors, encouraging them actually to sell up and move out the sector. Those are good, well-operating landlords in the sector that actually we want to keep, we don't want to get rid of. And perhaps a halfway house that we've been talking about for some months now is, would it not be better to keep the no-fault ground but make the period of notice a landlord must give to be much, much longer, therefore granting security and encouraging the tenants to take the action in the cases that we've been talking about.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Gordon.
Just in response to what you said, I'd remind you again that we don't represent landlords specifically in the RACS. I do, as a letting agent, but I took over the role of PRS forum chairman in the RACS a few years ago, and as soon as I did, the first thing that I did was met Douglas Robertson, who ran the tenancy review group eventually, and told him, because he'd led a consultation on something else similar, that they needed to change the tenancy regime, get rid of all the complex paperwork, introduce a new tenancy which was much simpler for tenants to understand and be able to enforce their rights, and for landlords to understand their rights as well, so that they could evict tenants. Because very often landlords who get into difficulties with tenants not paying don't have the right paperwork in place in order to be able to evict that tenant. So we're delighted that a new tenancy regime is being brought forward, and we were one of the few advocates of that within the tenancy review group that advocated it and recommended to the First Minister that it should be done. But nobody imagined that this is the position that we would end up in, removing the no-fault ground which has been there, and that's primarily because there isn't any evidence for that. What there is evidence of is some very bad practice in a proportion of properties which are rented out by landlords who misunderstand the law, think that the property is still theirs in effect, more than it is. They don't understand the fact that the tenant has the right to occupy the property as their home and feel that they're almost just like a visitor in the property and they can do what they like, they can come and go as they please. And that type of practice needs to be weeded out. But those type of landlords will still operate under the radar. And what we need is enforcement of the existing repairing standards, which were strengthened by, again, the RICS, leading on this with the National Electricians Council, recommended that the repairing standard was improved, and that's happening this year. So there are electrical safety checks, more main smoke alarms, carbon monoxide alarms, and portable appliance testing is all mandatory within the next 12 months. And that's all come about through RICS and other landlord bodies here recommending this should be done. And these all primarily protect tenants from poor landlords who don't manage their properties well. But what this bill is in danger of doing, in our view, is putting off the large number of corporate investors who we need in the market to improve the sector. So if we take a property that you might live in, imagine you're living in a one-bedroom flat in Gorgie, where the landlord, we meet them all the time, they have no proper heating system in the property, they have a couple of portable heaters, they have no proper decent windows, so they're old single glazing, they're not particularly great. But you could argue it meets the repairing standard because the windows are there, they're not broken. It does have heating that meets the repairing standard. But that landlord says to me, well, why should I put in a gas central heating system and replace the windows? Will I get more rent? And I say, well, no, probably not, because there's no properties available and tenants have to take it. What we need is blocks of new build properties, people coming into the market as corporate investors to improve the sector. And although I do have some sympathies with the no-fault ground and the security of tenure for tenants personally, I have investor clients, not enough, but ones who want to invest in the sector on a corporate basis, build blocks of flats, and they are pulling out of the market and making decisions not to. And we've had leads that we've put to them which they are no longer looking at for pieces of land to build houses on. And it's very specifically because of the rent control pressure zones and because of the lack of the loss of the no-fault ground. They will, if you look at the student blocks of flats as an example, the ones where they're built specifically for students, they do charge far higher rents than maybe I would think they should. £800 a month is the latest one, I believe, coming on. But the level of quality in those properties is amazing. When you go into the properties, they're well-maintained, they get service, everything's fixed immediately, and they get a very, very good customer service within those properties. If you go to a typical HMO flat managed by a landlord himself, it's average quality, but there are a number of properties that I've seen or taken over, managed by agents, where it's hard to believe that people are living there, even though there's an HMO licence, and we don't understand why the council has granted a licence for it, but it's not within their remit to say that it's not particularly good condition. But so if you want to improve the sector, you need more investment, and there is a danger this bill goes slightly too far just in terms of those two issues, rent protection zones and...
Yorker, do you want to come in?
Just to take Mr. McKenzie's point, we, as part of the CLA and a letting agent myself, I'm actively welcoming the proposed regulation of letting agents because I see that's the one way that we're going to be able to improve the housing stock and make letting agents represent maybe 50% of landlords in Scotland, make them accountable with a code of conduct that they have to answer for if they are providing properties that are substandard, lack of communication and lack of repairs. So I actually welcome that. In terms of the minimum length of a tenancy, you've got to remember that a lot of landlords maybe have one or two properties and they're not all getting £800 to £900 a month rent. I mean, my agencies are in Angus and I have properties myself in Angus. And, you know, one-bedroom properties are anything from £250 a month up. Now, for landlords, there's costs associated with a landlord putting a tenant in the property. They do all the credit checks. They've got to do all the safety checks when a tenant goes in. And there's lots of due diligence, and they will have a void period where that property is empty that they're accounting for. If they then absorb all of that cost and put a tenant in, and that tenant can leave at any point after that point, then the landlord will just make a loss. He won't be able to afford to take the risk of making that one-bedroom property, which is affordable housing for some people, available. And you might be in a scenario where he starts to sell that property because it's not viable for him anymore. So I think for me, 6 months to the other thing you have, if you don't have the 6 months, landlords might start to take shortcuts. They might think, well, you know, this tenant might leave in 2 or 3 months. I can't afford to do a credit check or my PAT testing, etc. So it could have implications in that as well. The other thing I find my experience of the no-fault ground is antisocial behaviour. You know, we have maybe instances where tenants are creating really happy environment for their neighbours. And the quickest route, really, to sort out that problem would be to give notice on the no-fault ground. It's very difficult and a long process to try and persuade neighbours and people living in that community to give evidence for antisocial behaviour, and it can drag on, and people are, you know, quite afraid sometimes to give that type of evidence. By having a no-fault ground to end the tenancy will enable us to deal with that situation quickly and for the benefit of everybody living in that community.
Yeah, I think we're going to move on. Alex, can you take us into
Thank you very much, convener. I was going to do the removal of the no-fault ground for repossession, but we've pretty much done that to death. Just initially, is there anyone who has anything to contribute in that who hasn't had the chance to do it yet?
I just like to say that we, going back to Mr. McKenzie's point as well, we don't agree that we do agree that the current system doesn't work. You know, we very much support what the review group said, a new tenancy is required. It doesn't work for tenants, as you've just described. There's problems. It also doesn't work for landlords, and that's why they're having to use what we're calling the no-fault ground, which is unfortunately named because people won't ask a tenant to leave when there is not a problem or the property is not needed for a legitimate reason. Also, I would just like to, can I just read to you from the review group's report? Just said, what would be put in its place following this modernisation exercise would be a clear route for landlord repossession where the tenant was found to be in breach of the new private tenancy or following the expiry of the agreed tenancy term. We're a bit concerned that this hasn't been recognised at all by Scottish Government, of why they're choosing to go against what the review group stated in their final report. Without the no-fault ground, the grounds have to be absolutely watertight in order to get the investment and the confidence from landlords and investors. And at the moment, we feel that there's holes there, and therefore the need for the ability to end at a tenancy at the end of the contract is still absolutely required.
The government and some of the witnesses we've spoken to have expressed the view that the removal of the no-fault ground will increase the confidence of tenants. It will allow the private rented sector to become a more long-term housing option, and that it could in some cases be viewed as a positive by some landlords. How do you react to that point of view?
So it could be a positive if the grounds are robust enough that landlords have confidence. From a rural point of view, we are working on quite a different background, I think, to where a lot of this has been drafted, considering that an urban tenancy is probably only about 18 months length that a tenant stays. In the rural sector, a tenant stays for much, much longer than that, and this all works rather well. The no-fault ground is used regularly because the other grounds don't work. It's also often used to a tenant's benefit. We have a lot of landlords who have experienced tenants coming to them and asking for their notice to quit because they're struggling either with the rent or the location. They want to move near family, near services, but in order to get onto social housing, they need to have a notice to quit. In this situation, they're not going to be able to come and ask for that. The landlord won't be able to provide that, and that puts tenants in a very difficult position. They're either going to have to breach their tenancy or going to have to stick it out in a property or in a location that's maybe not suitable for them.
So what I'm fishing for basically is, does anyone have anything positive to say about the removal of the no-fault ground?
I think, Mr. Blackwood, you wanted to come in?
Yeah, I think perhaps looking at it from a slightly different perspective, convener, is if we had full confidence in the existing system, the grounds for repossession, and indeed in the proposed new grounds, then actually we would feel there is no need for a no-fault ground. Because the only reason why a landlord would use a no-fault ground would be when something goes wrong, i.e. actually there is a fault, but it doesn't come within the categories of the grounds that we actually have at the moment. Or where the actual grounds that we have are not sufficient and they actually don't deal with the problem. Two of them, one being, first of all, antisocial behaviour. There is nobody in this land who would actually take a case to the court under the current system on an antisocial behaviour ground because it's so difficult to prove that evidence through the court. You're requiring on neighbours who often could be living in fear of their tenant next door to them engaging in antisocial behaviour or feel intimidated by them. Those neighbours need to take action. They need to stand as witnesses or give witness statements under the current regime They're often frightened to do so. So that leaves the landlord with no alternative in those scenarios than to actually issue what's called a no-fault ground, the Section 33 notice. In the future, if we don't have that, what's going to happen to those communities? How are those neighbours going to feel? It's fine granting greater security for that tenant, but what effect does that have for the wider community? Part of the reason for greater security of tenure is to create sustainable communities. And that's an issue we need to take on board and think, will it actually have that effect or be more detrimental? So under the new system, it's exactly the same ground. We will be needing those neighbours to take action and stand as witnesses, and we feel that's unfair on local communities to have to be put through that simply for one policy issue.
Dr. Boyle?
There's no point denying that there isn't a problem with the PRS. There are problems with the PRS, there's problems with the social rented sector, there's problems with the owner-occupied sector. I don't think you're living in a parallel universe. I just think you're probably only seeing a part of the universe. To set things in context, I don't think you're going to complain or you're going to go to your MSP if you're happy in your tenancy. You're going to go to your MSP or to organisations like Citizens Advice Bureau or Shelter if you're unhappy in your tenancy. So that's why you're seeing, I think, part of the universe. But if you put it into context, I mean, these are Scottish Government's own figures. 85% tenant satisfaction with providers in the PRS. Direct quote from the Scottish Government's review of the private rented sector said, vast majority of tenants are satisfied with their landlord, agent and their accommodation. A survey of 6,500 private tenants by letting stats showed just 14% of sitting tenants experienced a rent rise. 90% of tenants said they never experienced an unjustified rent increase. According to the Scottish House Condition Survey, only 6% of properties were below tolerable standard. While the proportion of PRS dwellings meeting the stringent Scottish housing quality standard broadly reflects that recorded for local authority and privately owned stock. So I think we've got to set it in the context that the vast majority of landlords and tenants within the PRS are happy and satisfied within the PRS. The danger is in drafting legislation to tackle those rogue elements, of which there is already legislation to deal with through landlord registration and enhanced enforcement areas, which Glasgow City Council has now applied for in Govan Hill. In dealing with those rogue elements, we actually hamper the rest of the sector and its ability to grow.
The final question I want to ask is one that we've already heard particularly from one witness about, and that is, do you believe that the removal of the no-fault ground for repossession will affect investment in the sector?
Mr. Gordon and then Mr. Cox.
It already has affected it. So, in a perfect world where you started with a blank sheet, this is maybe what you would do. But everybody here must or should be aware of all the discussions about building a private rented sector where you're building blocks of flats like you have in other countries. One of the biggest problems that we have, which I didn't quite finish when I was referring to your point, was the way to get that flat with a poor condition fixed is to have a block of good flats next to it, because then their market rent will suffer because people won't rent it and they'll have to reduce the rent or fix it. This bill doesn't fix that, because regardless of whether it's a good measure or not, the sentiment that's felt amongst the corporate investors is that, yes, they've currently got lots of money floating around within the investment market to invest in things like housing, but why would they invest it here rather than in England? And that is the choices that they're making, but very often it's European funds and they've got multiple choices across Europe to do that. So if the no-fault ground was needed, I think it's a very good bill, but I just don't think it's needed. It's not the problem. It doesn't fix the problem. The problem is the rogue landlords who still won't have a lease that's drafted properly. There's going to be a prescribed lease within this legislation, and if somebody could take a note to please stop calling it a model tenancy, because then people will think they've just got to model it on it. It's going to have specific clauses in it which must be adhered to and copied word for word. then it should be a prescribed lease rather than a model lease. That lease in itself will identify the repairing standard, which should be included within your lease at the moment, but very few people do. So tenants rarely understand what their rights are that they can enforce. And by having that and then strengthening the private rented housing panel, if your heating's not working, you complain to the private rented housing panel. It's no good sending a letter to the landlord giving them 3 months to reply or a month to reply or whatever it is. You need to have immediate enforcement so that you'd send somebody out to actually check. Well, meet the tenant. They can invite them into their home because it's their home and they have the right to bring anyone in. Check if there is a problem and then, you know, take action on it. And that kind of enforcement, it's not an insignificant proportion. It's not tiny, it's not small, but it's small enough that wouldn't be a huge cost to have that kind of enforcement and have surveyors or other qualified people who sit on housing panels anyway, you know, made available to pop in. And I would do it for nothing, to pop into properties and check if there is a basic problem. So, but that, you know, it makes the Barry Stocker, you can name him. So he was involved heavily in the drafting of this legislation as one of the civil servants. So he's the civil servant who represented the Scottish Government most of the discussions with stakeholders regarding drafting the legislation.
For anyone who's watching at home, for anyone who doesn't know.
So Barry has engaged with all the stakeholders like ourselves that are here today and other groups. And, you know, without naming the other person on the side, there's somebody who's a big advocate who works with investors and is very against the idea of removing the no-fault ground because they want to see better properties. And they've said that if they lose their job, then they're going to go out and start a vigilante group to go out for the rogue landlords in a jokey way. But that is the problem, is that rogue landlords are not being tackled. And this bill doesn't help that. So we need to have good enforcement of what's already there and better investment in the sector to drive up standards.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Cox.
I would actually echo pretty much everything that Mr. Gordon has just said. We are already seeing, with the idea of this bill coming into force, institutional investors particularly who were looking at Scotland are seeing the other nations of the United Kingdom as better investment opportunities, particularly London, but now as well Cardiff is going through a very similar tenancy reform programme. They've kept the no-fault possession ground in the Welsh Bill, the Renting Homes Bill in Wales. And actually, it goes back to something that you were saying around the heating system and being evicted, the retaliatory eviction aspect. And to try and overcome that one in Wales and in Westminster as well, they have kept no-fault possession but put restrictions on where tenants complain about quality of the properties. And I would echo very much what Jonathan was saying, that investors will be looking for regulatory certainty. Constant changes in legislation do not help. In fact, they massively hinder investment in the sector. It's why organisations such as RICS have been talking for 20, 30 years about how do we get more institutional investment into the UK's private rented sector in all nations of the country. How do we replicate the sort of levels of institutional investment that exist in most other mature private rented markets, Germany, France, the United States? It is because they've got much greater regulatory certainty. Laws aren't changing on such a regular basis, and they don't have the problems, again, echoing what other stakeholders have said around the enforcement aspect.
Can I just ask you, why do you think it's not possible for there to be stronger enforcement of existing legislation and the end of the no-fault repossession? Why can't they be pursued?
I would argue they're two very different issues. Enforcement is one of the biggest problems in this industry, not just in Scotland, but across the United Kingdom. We just don't have the necessary level of enforcement activity. And something that we're very much arguing for is that local authorities, the prosecuting body, should be able to keep the fines. Those fines should be ring-fenced for greater enforcement activity so that at the moment in the times of austerity that we've got, local authority, environmental health departments, trading standards departments are revenue drains on council resources as opposed to revenue generators. If we can flip that balance, we can have more enforcement officers doing more prosecution to actually rid the rogue element of the sector. But I don't think this bill will actually assist in that. It's looking at a different issue, whereas I would argue that the big problem that we have is that the legislation exists, and there is a lot of very good legislation in Scotland and is coming in Scotland under the letting agent regulation. We need proper enforcement to get rid of a tiny minority who bring the entire industry into disrepute.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Fiorca.
Go back to Mr. Johnson's point about the no-fault ground and will it have an impact on investors. We're talking about large investors, but you've got to take yourselves out of the cities and look at the small towns and villages around Scotland, which doesn't make it viable for large investors to invest in that area to provide housing. And the people that are buying houses in that area are the small landlords that probably live in that small town that are buying that property. And it's those people that are worried and those people that are scared that the no-fault ground will take away their flexibility to take their property back, and it's those people that will stop investing, and that will have a huge impact in the very rural and small towns and villages across Scotland.
Okay, Mr. Blackwood, and then
just really to pick up on Amanda's point there that she was making, convener, that at the end of the day, landlords are investors in the sector, not just as institutional investors or in our big cities, but in our rural communities as well too. And if you're telling any investor on any sector that, do you know what, we're going to limit potentially your ability to sell this investment, to move back into it if you want to use it for your own use, or indeed bring it to an end when the situation goes wrong, then that naturally will have an effect long-term on investment in the sector. And that's what none of us want.
Ms. Dixon.
I agree with a lot of what has been said, particularly from a rural perspective. Our members aren't necessarily going to run away from their housing stock. They may look, however, to assess it, and unfortunately it will be the affordable housing that they're currently offering that will probably take the first cut if they do decide to change their portfolio at all. The other thing I just wanted to mention is that we do have a private rented sector champion who was appointed by the Scottish Government to attract more institutional investment. I don't want to speak on his behalf, but as far as I was concerned during the consultation stage, he had very similar concerns to what we're talking about. Jerry Moore.
Okay, thank you. Mike.
Thank you, convener. I just wondered if our guests agree with me that over the last 15, 20 years, the private rented sector has represented not a good investment, but a superb investment. And that the evidence for that is the growth of the private rented sector, a phenomenal growth we've seen over a fairly short period of time. The evidence is the continuation of the availability of finance for the sector and buy-to-let mortgages and such like continuing right throughout the credit crunch. And that the evidence for that is in the huge differential between the cost of home ownership and home rental. And so what we're talking about, just to put this in context, is perhaps the difference between this being a superb investment and maybe not quite such a superb investment. And
I think you made your point well. Who wants to tackle that? I'm keen to get through as much of the bill as we can. Mr. Gordon.
So the superb investment part of it is primarily related to the capital value of the property. And one of the things that I'll come on to later when they talk about rent controls is that it's the capital value of the property and the lack of available land for housing and the cost of land for housing and the value of housing that is the problem. It's not the rental price and it's not the condition of the rental properties related to that income. So most of our landlords, we've got probably 50%, I would guess, we started 8 years ago, and maybe 50% didn't really mean to be landlords. They couldn't sell their property or wasn't able to sell their property and get their money back for their mortgage. And they are renting out their property, and especially with all the new changes that we've actually advocated and new smoke alarms and things like that, some of them are making no money this year or previous years. So it isn't really the rental that's the issue, it's the capital value of the property that's making a superb investment. And that's a separate issue.
But it is still superb.
No, not in every area, so only in some areas. So the value of your property that you bought in 2008 in Falkirk will have gone down by a significant value, and you will be making significant losses, and you'll be renting out your property at a loss as well. based on the mortgage that you're paying. And that's the only example outside of Edinburgh I have. But I'd imagine other people
okay, thank you.
Have examples, of course.
Going to bring in Dr. Boyle, and I'm going to move on.
Yeah. I think, again, it's important to set it in context. The average gross yield on a buy-to-let property, UK-wide, is 5.8%. Net yield is around about 3%. You can compare that with the net yield on commercial property, which is around about 6%. As Mr. Gordon said, I think you know, the reason that most investors are in the buy-to-let sector isn't because they're making a killing on rents. It's for the capital appreciation over the long term. If you go back 40 years in Scotland, say back to 1975, the average annual capital appreciation in real terms is 1.8%, which is fine. You would think compound that over 40 years and you've probably got a decent pension, but it's fairly modest. And it swings in roundabouts. Between 2001 and 2007, if you get into the housing market in 2001, between 2001 and 2007, property prices doubled. If you got into the housing market in 2007, it's likely, in real terms, on average, you'll be making a loss of around about 10 to 15%. And that again, varies by location across the country. Some of the studies that have been undertaken on comparing home ownership with rental accommodation, in my view, are very misleading. What they tend to do is they just look at the mortgage against the rent paid, very simplistically, for different house types across the country. They don't take account of the size of deposit that's been put down for the mortgage property. They don't take account of refurbishment. They don't take account of other costs, such as insurance. What we need is a better kind of evidence base, I think.
Thank you. We're going to move on to another section, and Clare Adamson is going to introduce that.
It's something we've also already touched on, is trying to get a bit more information about the effect on the student and holiday let part of the economy in this area. And I was just wondering if there is an exception in the bill for student accommodation which relates to the status of the landlord where it is an educational institution, but educational institutions also do holiday lets in areas as well. And I just wondered if you had any comment about that part of the bill.
Mr. Warwick.
Thank you, Convener. I think this is an area which is of great concern to the industry as a whole. Tourism is something that needs to be looked at, and the leisure industry that looks for the holiday lets. To start with, if we can look at the sort of the student side, which you've introduced there, a student by its very nature is probably going to rent for a period of 4 years at the most. They're going to graduate, move on in their lives. And in my experience as the letting agent, there are two requirements from the students. One is either they wish to rent their accommodation on an annual basis so that they don't get moved out in order to accommodate holiday lets, or there are the others who actually wish to rent for 9 or 10 months to allow for the holiday activity to take place. Now, the flaw, I think, in the way that the bill is drafted at the moment means that the typical student is going to be presented with two different things. On the one hand, they're going to be offered an opportunity from the university accommodation, which is going to be telling them they can have it for 9 months. Then the rest of the industry, the private landlords who've got the HMO properties and that kind of thing, are going to be offering them something totally different, which is actually currently what is suggesting is that the tenants are going to be offered to come into a property and at their behest at some stage in the future, three or four of these tenants are going to get their heads around the idea that they've got to serve a notice to leave on the landlord to say when they're going to go. Now, we'll probably come to talk about that in a little bit more detail. But my initial response to your question is that there is a huge area around here which needs to be investigated. Dr. Boyle has talked about some statistics and things like that. I think there's a huge area around this particular part of the marketplace as well that actually needs to have some statistical elements brought into it so that we can actually examine what the market needs, because this doesn't meet what it needs at the moment.
Mr. Blackwood.
Just to pick up on some of those points, again, I think it's a particularly unique sector, the student sector in Scotland. We're talking generally about security of tenure for all tenants, and you can argue why should students be any different to anybody else, but it is a unique sector, and I think cognizance of that should be given in any production, perhaps, of a new ground for repossession. My initial reaction is I think it's unfair that particular landlords, like the educational providers, have the right to bring the tenancy to an end, but then individual investors who are in the same marketplace are not allowed to do that. We would say that's anti-competitive. One of the reasons why it's a good idea to have that perhaps ground for repossession is in order for students to plan for the future so that they know where they're going to be the next term. Maybe in the first year they're in halls, they're within these educational establishments, but that's for a fixed period, then they have to move on. And often they choose to move on. You know, students, many of us have been there where you think it's a great idea to share with your pals in a flat. You don't want to be in halls anymore. And then a year later, you decide something different. But nevertheless, that's the marketplace. But importantly, parents are looking for their kids to be accommodated. So the market is such that at the beginning of the year, around springtime, Easter time, they're actually looking to secure accommodation for the next academic year. So September, October time. Now, the students themselves might not be too worried about that, but I'm sure their parents are, because they want to get the best value for money that they possibly can and know that their son and daughter are not going to be scrambling for accommodation at last minute. With taking away the no-fault ground and not having a provision for student accommodation, that will mean that that market will change dramatically. So there'll be fewer properties available when students are actually looking for the properties. What will that mean? Inevitably, rents will go up, and there'll probably be a sacrifice of accommodation standards as well, too. So overall, we don't feel that that's productive for the sector at all.
Anyone else? Mr. Gordon?
So just to remind everybody, there are three different parts of the student sector. So there's the part that's excluded, that's owned and operated by the universities themselves, and they won't operate under this tenancy, and they don't operate under the current short-term tenancy. Then there's the investment market, where they've built blocks of student housing specifically for the student market, and they rent out the rooms. As well as representing the RICS here, I represent the RICS on the PRS working party, which is run by Jerry Moore, and he's not here today, but that's looking at getting more investment into the sector. So they are dealing with the investors who have these student blocks and are considering building more of them in Edinburgh. And there is a big fear that some investments will be withdrawn if this goes ahead, and some of the current investments will fail to meet just basically their targets. And they will have funding for running those developments, and they'll have planned for 10-month lets, some of them, to students, and then renting them out for the summer to the festival or whatever in Edinburgh in particular. And to change something and change their business model when they've already invested, some of these blocks have just still been built at the moment and they've invested in them, I think is an unfair move to make, and some exemptions should be made, if not allowing a new ground for eviction. But the biggest thing is that everybody that's been to university knows that you plan ahead for your accommodation, and these blocks need to plan for their new people coming in and be able to offer them accommodation. If students are able to stay in a property as long as they want and then just tell them, well, I'm off, I'm quitting university, I'm going around the world, and say they're suddenly leaving at any particular time, how's that room's then going to be empty? And how are they going to fill it in March when there's no new students coming in? So it's not a clever idea to include students, and I don't really understand why it got included in the first place. I don't think anybody's asked for it. Shelter have not asked for it. None of the organisations that I'm aware of asked for it, perhaps other than the National Union of Students and their considerations. But that students are living in rooms for the term and then leaving very often, and to consider them amongst normal working people or people who are renting a home is totally different. So one thing that the RICS was particularly concerned about, which is in the third sector, so having mentioned that one, I think that's a big issue, but A separate issue is in all the HMO properties and other properties rented to students in Edinburgh, where again, for the festival, has anybody spoken to the tourist sector or Visit Scotland about the impact this is going to have on availability of accommodation? So already there is a huge shortage of accommodation, and we know of a letting agent which specifically focuses on Edinburgh Festival lets, and they work with the students. The students clean the properties, clean all the bedding, and get the properties ready for the people coming for the festival for that month of August. And all that requires huge amounts of planning by not just the owners, but the agencies working on their behalf for all these tourists from America or wherever who are coming and thinking about coming next year. How are they going to plan for that? It's just, so a major rethink has to happen regarding that for both those types of properties, for the individual investor
so
with an HMO property. What was my last word? So I think that was a major part of our thinking within our forum, was that the need to consider and discuss this in more detail with the Edinburgh Festival organisers and Visit Scotland, just in terms of general tourism for Edinburgh and other areas, because I guess tourism, I don't know Glasgow and Aberdeen, but they must require that kind of accommodation during the summer as well.
Thank you, Mr Gordon, and my apologies for the distraction. Clare, don't you want to...
The policy memorandum in paragraph 68 of the bill states that the Scottish Government considers that all tenants, including students, should have the same security of tenure, and that practices could be adapted in order to mitigate the impacts of the new tenancy, such as engaging effectively with tenants to establish their plans to remain or to give up the tenancy, and marketing the properties for a shorter time frame. Is this something that people recognise could be possible?
On that. Mm-hmm. We've only got a small number of HMO properties, mm-hmm. and we try to engage with them in the current system. It is almost impossible to engage with students to understand what their plans are already. If they then realise that they don't have to do any planning at all until they decide to leave, it will be the sector won't survive it in the same way as it functions at the moment, I don't think.
Dr. Boyle.
Yeah, there's a question there about how the market will adjust. I think there's a kind of a hope in what's been written in the document at the moment that the market will just kind of adjust in a kind of an unspecified way, but it'll be all right. 75% of students are in HMOs who aren't staying at home. If enough of those private sector landlords decide renting to students as opposed to young professionals, there's plenty of demand for young professionals in places like Edinburgh and Glasgow for accommodation. If renting to students becomes more risky and complicated and they can't get the yield by letting out during the festival, they're going to move across the market. They're going to leave the student market and they're going to move to another part of the market. That's going to reduce the supply, as Mr Blackwood said, of student stock quite considerably. I think that's a real danger. But the other risk is how the purpose-built student accommodation providers react. They've been in this market building a lot of accommodation, including in Scotland, in recent years. This is a quote from Unite from the second consultation. They're one of the largest providers. In the event there is no fair opportunity to assess student accommodation in Scotland, students may want to select the security provided by the English and Welsh legislation, as we would not be in a position to guarantee a room in Scotland in advance of receiving notice from the current tenant. Again, it's going to make Scotland a less attractive place to be building this type of stock. I know from speaking to some of the purpose-built student accommodation providers, confidentially, that some of them are thinking of converting some of their existing student stock, going to planning, and converting it into stock for young professionals, of which they think there is ample demand in places like Edinburgh and Glasgow. So we'll lose even more student accommodation. Now, this is something over the last 9 months that the sector picked up on very quickly and has been making representations, I think, quite strongly to government on this. It still seems as if it's something that it's almost at the settled will of the government that we're not going to change this. Students are going to get the exact same rights as other tenants, and we will see how the market adjusts. My warning is that if something isn't done about it, then I wouldn't want to be a student in early 2018 after this has been implemented.
Mr. Blackwood. Maybe just very briefly come back on a point with regards to the practicalities and how the market might adjust. Everything's planned in advance from the holiday accommodation through to the beginning of the next term and new tenants moving in. So well in advance, landlords are in the habit of signing leases. Obviously, a lease cannot be agreed unless they know they'll have vacant possession at X date. So therefore, the landlords won't be in the position, even if the tenants are looking for that and saying, can I do this in the future, next year, there's a new group wanting to move in. Sorry, we won't be able to secure that accommodation for you at this stage. The final point was just with regards to holiday accommodation. That's done well in advance too. People are looking to plan holidays months and months in advance. And it's not just festival accommodation, it can be any sporting activity or whatever throughout the whole of Scotland. So again, landlords wouldn't be in the position to offer the accommodation for tourists during the summer period, for instance, in advance, because they wouldn't know that that property is going to be available. So again, it will have an adverse effect on tourism locally, as well as obviously future student accommodation, which means everybody will be looking at the last minute and they'll have to pay more for the accommodation, which need not be the case. Mr. Warwick.
Thank you, Convener. I won't repeat what all my colleagues have been saying, but at the end of the day, the intent that is written here about engaging with the tenants is great. That's exactly what we do at the moment. And in doing that, we actually rely on what is embodied in the legislation. So we're using the legislation and engaging with the student population in order to achieve a workable outcome. So this idea about having engagement with them is great. That's what we do right now. But that engagement, if we haven't got the right legislation sitting behind us, won't work. And somewhere along the line, we need to have something which allows us to give to the tenant, depending upon what they choose, either 9 or 10 months or a 12-month tenancy, which we know is going to come to an end or can be renewed. There are a number of different options which actually work really well at the moment, and I would advocate that we try and learn from the experience which currently operates and see how we can actually travel that into this bill so that we can actually get something that functions.
Clear?
Anyone else on this issue? If not, we'll move on. Mike.
Thank you, Convener. We've already discussed, to a certain extent, the no-fault eviction, but there are a number of legitimate grounds for the bill that are, or that the bill suggests is legitimate grounds for eviction. I wonder how our witnesses feel about those legitimate grounds. Other than that, we've already heard about, you know, the antisocial tenant problem. Other than that, can you give examples of particular problems that you think may arise with these grounds as they're laid out in the bill?
There are a few, so try and be as brief as I possibly can. If you look at rent arrears, first of all, that show, if you try and timeline how long it would take under the new system, it could potentially be longer than what we have under the current system in order to take action. At the moment, obviously, if there's rent arrears, a landlord can issue the Section 33 notice, the no-fault ground. So they can do that by giving 2 months' notice. The current ground requires 3 months rent arrears before you can take action. Now, what we've been lobbying the Scottish Government to do is to say, can we actually take action, i.e. instigate action at an earlier stage? Now, at the moment, under the proposals within the bill, you will have to have the tenant who's in rent arrears for 3 months, or consistently so for 3 months, before issuing the notice to leave, which will have a month's notice period on it. Now, That's in order to gain a mandatory ground for repossession, effectively, if they're more than a month in rent arrears, which is fine, don't in principle have an issue with that, but it's actually how long it will actually take to go through the legal process. So effectively, if you do a timeline, you could be 5, 6, maybe even 7 months down the line before you can actually get before the tribunal for them to make a decision. And then quite rightly so, the tribunal will be saying, if eviction is granted, then it would be another month hence, or quite rightly, as I say. So that actually it could be a protracted period of time where what we're asking for is, could we instigate legal proceedings at an earlier stage in the sense of to get to the state of the hearing? And then at the hearing, they, of course, can decide whether you've actually got a substantive ground for repossession or not. So we have not so much a concern about the right and the rights contained within the ground, it's how long the process is going to take. And in reality, that could be potentially longer than what we've got at the moment. We've got a number of unknown quantities here. We're thinking about the current court system, how long and how expensive that is for all parties, and the public purse as well too. But under the new tribunal system, we're hoping that will be quicker, less adversarial, so it'll be more inquisitorial, all of which we welcome and think is a very positive step. But it's still going to take time to go through that process, and we don't know how long that's going to be. So we have concerns about the period. With regards to the ground, the mandatory ground for repossession and rent arrears, then that's, of course, 1 month rent arrears, therefore mandatory, it's a mandatory ground for repossession. But there is a potential that a tenant, if granted security of tenure for life effectively, could constantly be almost 1 month in rent arrears forever. And there'd be no legal grounds that the landlord would have to take action to repossess that property or reclaim that money. And we feel that's inequitable, then that's essentially unfair there. So, and we have mentioned antisocial behaviour ground. We have lobbied for the abandonment ground to be put in there, so we welcome that and we thank the Scottish Government for taking heed of that. However, you're not allowed to use the antisocial behaviour ground within the initial period of let, which could be 6 months, could be a year. So if somebody abandons the property, sorry, I mean the abandonment ground, if they abandon the property, then effectively what will actually happen is you would have to wait 6 months or 12 months before using that ground, which ultimately means that property is lying empty all of that time, and that's unfair too. So the abandonment ground should be used at any point during the tenancy, assuming it's genuine abandonment and the tribunal has decided such and has granted the repossession. So there's two main issues that we have with the existing ground.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Blackwood. I think I'm going to move now to suspend this meeting in advance of the 2 minute silence at 11 o'clock, and I'll advise all of those present when that is. Ladies and gentlemen, can I ask members, witnesses and those in the public gallery to be upstanding to observe a 2-minute silence to commemorate Remembrance Day. Thank you very much, everyone. We'll now continue. Mike, did you want to?
Yes, thank you, convener. My next question, to a certain extent, has been preempted, but last week the committee heard from Shelter, who were concerned that the ground in relation to eviction for rent arrears was too draconian. And they described a scenario whereby a tenant that maybe fell into partial arrears, say, in the first month of a tenancy, made the next couple of months' payments but was unable to catch up on the arrears from the first month would be subject to eviction, despite the fact that, you know, that may not be in the landlord's interest, really, as well as the tenant's. So I just wondered what you felt about that. There seems to be a kind of different interpretations of this, so I'm interested to hear from witnesses how they feel about that.
It would be discretionary, so it's not a mandatory ground for eviction. So if a landlord was to do that, was to take action on for that reason, then it would be up to the tribunal, obviously, to decide whether does that warrant eviction effectively. And the nature of the tribunal is to be more inquisitorial, so it's looking at the situation. Why is that the case? You know, they maybe lost their job, you know, it's just fallen in hard times or whatever, they have got a plan to pay that up, or they're seeking money advice, you know, solutions, whatever. To be honest, I'd be very surprised at any landlord that would take such action and go to such extremes for just partial rent arrears. Unless, of course, as I'm saying, that perhaps they're deliberately doing it just to be short of the 1 month, which is a potential pitfall here. And that could be for many, many months. And I think, well, that's unreasonable. They're just trying not to pay almost a month's rent. So, again, the tribunal would look at that case on its own merits. So I think there's fair safeguards there for tenants in that situation. So I think, in fairness, there's a balance has been struck in how it's been drafted. It's just potentially how long the process could take, not knowing how long it will be by the time you apply to the new tribunal system and actually have your hearing. So
that's a very useful insight.
Anyone else on that specific point?
Thank you. I think we just have to keep in mind that the maximum deposit a landlord can take is only 2 months, the equivalent of 2 months' rent. So if they can't be evicted until 3 months that's where they start taking action. And then we don't know how long, obviously, it will take until the tenant actually leaves, which is a further period that probably rent won't be paid. So you're already well out of pocket before you even begin to decide if there's any repairs or damage that's been done to the property.
Okay. Anyone else? Mr. Gordon?
Just on that, picking up on that point, I think it's worth remembering, because I'm not sure it's specifically been said, that 70% or so of landlords are individuals with one property or one or two properties. And they often just became a landlord by accident. So they bought a bigger house, they kept hold of it either because they couldn't sell it or because they thought that would be a good idea for a pension. But until it becomes a pension and they're paying a mortgage, the budgets can be very tight. And so although the tenant should be protected, I think that's the first job of the tribunal, to protect the vulnerable tenants where they can, with the discretionary liability on that rent thing. It's important to remember that, you know, we've got a landlord who's moved from another agent because they were not collecting rent on a tenant and they weren't pursuing it well enough, or so they thought, but there were deeper problems than that. But that landlord in particular, you know, has moved into a property and had to rent out that property because they couldn't sell it to get enough to pay off the mortgage. And, you know, they're on the verge of becoming homeless or losing their property because they can't afford to keep up the mortgage payments. And you know, we've given them, I shouldn't say more praises, we've given them no management fees for 6 months to help them because their budgets were that tight. And we've managed to fix a lot of the problems in that property. But it must be remembered that there are significant numbers of the sector who are just doing their best, and they have very tight budgets as well. So losing a month or two's rent may sound not too much for a business, but they should be treated as a business in some ways, but it must be remembered that they are just normal people who maybe have a property that's going to be their pension when they retire. And that's it.
Okay, Ms. Yorka.
Looking at tenants that rent arrears and looking at the inability for the no-fault ground, I think it's going to force landlords to be more and more selective about who they put in their properties. So people that maybe have had a history of non-payment of rent, those landlords, new landlords, will not be prepared to give them a second chance. So any risk at all associated with putting anybody in their property is going to be heightened, and I think we're going to see those tenants that maybe have got a property being forced to the lower end of the market and more into the rogue landlords. And I think we really need to take that into consideration of the impact all of this legislation has had on the ability of tenants to find good properties with the landlords.
OK. Mike?
I understand that some landlords are able to take out rent insurance to insure themselves against the event of non-payment. I've only become aware of this recently, but do any of you have any experience of rent insurance?
Yeah,
is yours positive, though? I think one of the concerns is, you imagine, there are insurance products, and if there's a way of getting out of paying, then some of these products will find a way of doing that. So often landlords find it's just not cost-effective to have such insurance policies because there's so many caveats under which it would not pay out. Or indeed, they require the tenants to fulfil certain criterion about their financial ability to pay, whether they're on benefits or not, etc., etc. So it means that the actual products, they're obviously geared up to make sure that there'll be fewer and fewer claims as possible. So they do exist in the marketplace, but I think fewer and fewer landlords and agents are actually using those products because of literally their ability to pay out if you ever needed to do that.
Expensive excesses are large, and we did offer them to all our clients at one point, and nobody took them. And what we do is we do a robust referencing system. And the first thing that we want as an agency is we want to have a tenant who will look after the property and pay the rent on time. And we do have tenants who go through a referencing process and they don't quite meet it. We sometimes ask for a higher deposit, not more than the 2 months, but we only take just over 1 month normally. So we might take a slightly higher deposit. We might ask them for a guarantor, even if they're not a student, and their parents can step in. But all these... You know, any reasonable property in reasonable condition in a decent area in Edinburgh that we advertise at the moment, we are inundated with people wanting to view the property and take the property. And rather than trying to work with good tenants particularly, we will be looking for the most robust, definite reference checking process. So we'll be trying to strengthen that. It may be that people who we would let have a guarantor will not do that anymore and just move to the next person. So that it does change the market a bit, and I think just got to be cautious about what you wish for if you're working in the sector where you're trying to help tenants. You make it more difficult. You might make it more difficult for your tenants that you're trying to protect as well.
And just one final question, Convener. We've already touched on the business of the antisocial tenants, and just to correct perhaps what a slight misapprehension that MSPs, I think, see perhaps more of the universe than you might assume, because some of the complaints that are brought to their attention in the matter, for instance, of antisocial tenants, on investigation you find that are not reasonable. And I think there is a difficulty here that the legislation is attempting to resolve, and that is that the person that constitutes an antisocial tenant in some eyes is not really all that antisocial, perhaps in other eyes. So, and yet, you know, evicting somebody from their home can be really quite a harsh penalty. I mean, you can commit, you know, certain criminal, crimes of some significance and not find yourself the victim of a penalty as severe as losing your home. So I just wonder what your comments would be in resolving this in a kind of general way. Do you feel the bill, you know, does offer reasonable opportunity of evicting antisocial tenants or not?
Mr. Cox.
I think the answer would be no, we don't think it's sufficient. And it falls down predominantly because it is the discretionary ground rather than the mandatory ground. As I think Mr. Blackwood mentioned earlier, trying to actually use the existing antisocial behaviour ground is exceptionally difficult. One of the main problems, and a house in multiple occupation is probably the easiest example to use, where you've got potentially four or five people, unrelated people, living together. If one is causing antisocial behaviour, it's going to be the other people in the property, the neighbours that are complaining. But with it as a may as opposed to a must, there's no guarantee that if the other people living in the property give evidence against that single person who's causing or making their lives a misery, and the court then doesn't uphold it, that person is coming back to live with those other four people, which will make the living situation very, very difficult. There will be fear of retribution against the people that have testified, and therefore we're actually talking more a personal safety ground as much as anything for landlords, for neighbours, for other tenants living in the property, where there is these sort of antisocial behaviour situations going on. There's intimidation, there's threatening, and therefore a landlord will not use that ground at the moment, and as a discretionary ground in the bill, I would be very surprised if any landlord or agent actually uses it for fear of the consequences if they're not successful.
Mr. Blackwood.
Just to, again, come in on that point that we've already been talking about today, I appreciate, but a thrust of the bill is about creating strong, sustainable communities and how the Scottish Government believes that's really important, where tenants can feel through the security of tenure that they are part of that community and they can contribute in a much more fulfilling way to that community. Coming with that is also a responsibility to act neighbourly. And you're quite right in saying that, of course, what's antisocial behaviour to one might not be to another, but we have to be cognisant of the expectations and the needs of our neighbours too. And ultimately, it'd be up to any tribunal to decide whether there's enough evidence or whether it's good enough to grant and warrant eviction. And I would put the power within the tribunal to make a balanced and a proper decision on that. My greater concern is not about trivial issues, because in most cases, trivial issues can be dealt with, or the landlord, quite frankly, would be turning round saying, you think I'm going to put out a good, decent tenant who's actually paying the rent, complying with a tenancy agreement, just because, quite frankly, you don't like them. That's unacceptable, and I hope the landlords would take a strong view on that too. And ultimately, as I say, the tribunal would anyway. Our issue is really where it's actually real antisocial behaviour that is disrupting our communities. And we feel landlords have a duty under the 2004 Act to take action, but under this new bill, they'd be stymied in any action that they could potentially take.
OK, thank you. We need to move on. Siobhan.
Convener, my first question has already been answered, so if I just move to my second. Section 43 of the bill provides that during the initial period of lease, the landlord can end the tenancy using any one of the 5 out of 16 eviction grounds. Are you happy with the bill's approach in this regard?
Ms Dixon.
I'd just like to repeat what John had said earlier, that we'd like to see the abandonment ground added in there as well. So that tenant can take, landlord can take swift action if they've got good reason to believe a property has been abandoned.
So you don't disagree with the list as it is, you just like an addition to it?
That's right.
Yes. Is that a consensus there?
Can I concur with that, and in particular in our submission we were mentioning grounds 9, 14, 15 and 16 okay. to be added to that list.
Thank you. Mr Gordon?
I think I concur with all that, and just maybe on abandonment, could something be done whereby sheriff's officers are not that expensive? So if you're able to serve a notice on the abandonment ground and then you know, take your property back if nobody comes back to that notice to say, yes, I am living here, that could speed things up.
Okay.
Do any of the members have any questions on that? If not, I'm going to ask Adam to introduce the next section.
Okay, these are issues associated with the tribunal. And Mr Blackwood is already concerned about the length of time it would get, the process to get to tribunal. Maybe you could comment on that. But also, I'd like some comments about your confidence on whether the tribunal will improve access to justice for landlords, or have you any particular concerns about how it's going to operate?
Convener, if I may start by declaring an interest, I hold a public appointment as a member of the Private Rented Housing Panel and the Homeowners Housing Panel, so I'd be one of these people. So I have a vested interest, obviously, in discussing the panel and its jurisdiction. Importantly, in saying that, though, I think a tribunal service is a much more appropriate way of doing justice. It would be consistent, and as I say, I'm one of those members of 3 members who would constitute the committee who would make a decision on this. They are specialists in housing law, they're specialists in their field, much different to what we have under the current court system. It's less adversarial, the idea is sitting around a table, it's discussing the issue, it's coming up with solutions potentially, which might not be eviction. So it's looking at the situation from a much more holistic perspective. Tribunals, we know, are much less expensive to the public purse too, and they can happen locally as well, wherever they need to be convened. So I think there's great positives in the new tribunal system. My concerns about how long was, as with any system, whatever system we have, if you can't apply until after 3 months, well, after 3 months, you'd be issuing the notice to leave, which would take you to 4 months, potentially, of rent arrears, and then you're applying to the tribunal, which, with the best will in the world, could be another month, 2 months before that could actually be arranged locally to you. So you could be without rent for 5-6 months easily, which isn't the intention of the initial ground. So all we're asking for is, can we raise proceedings at an earlier stage, which would still protect interests of the tenant, because ultimately it would be the tribunal that would decide if that ground was warranted.
Okay. Anyone else?
Moving on then, Shelter Scotland last week suggested the tribunal should have discretion to adjourn tribunal proceedings, for example, to monitor payments relating to rent arrears or to monitor a tenant's behaviour in antisocial behaviour cases. What's your view on that?
Katie, Ms Dixon, I should say.
Thank you. Can I just go back to the first point? We very much welcome the tribunal system, but we very much ask that we don't have an underestimation of the resources that are required. This needs to have be well-staffed and well-resourced so that it can deal with cases quickly until it proves itself it can be considered a risk, although albeit a nicer option than what we currently have, which we know definitely doesn't work. The discretion to adjourn, we would be very concerned about that. It adds an additional risk to a risky system. We don't know how long that could go on for. Will it be that a tenant can, will be given another 6 months? If it's got to the stage that the landlord's taking them to the tribunal, there's obviously a problem and it needs to be dealt with robustly.
Okay, Mr. Blackwood.
Just briefly on that point, the tribunal service does have an ability to adjourn, so any tribunal could be adjourned if the panel members so deem that appropriate.
Okay, fine. The final point was on wrongful termination. Could I ask for your views on the provisions that are in the bill? And again, it was hinted that, not so much hinted as actually expressed, that the proposed compensation of up to 3 months' rent was a somewhat limited and it needed to be significantly higher, as it is in some cases just now, I believe, for wrongful termination. Could I have your views on that, please?
Who wants to tackle that?
I'm happy to jump in. Actually, I think it's pretty balanced what the proposal is, but you might not be surprised to hear me say that from the private renter's perspective. I think it's important that whatever comes out of this as the final act is that it does have teeth and it is robustly enforced. And that's one theme that we've really been bringing through this whole evidence session. There is no point in having law which effectively will not be enforced or not do the job it's intended to do. So quite rightly, as we want a well-functioning private rented sector, we want landlords to be complying with the law. And quite frankly, if they're taking advantage of that, then there should be adequate provision to take action against them. I would say the 3 months is adequate, to be honest. The issue is going to be in evidencing that and actually proving that. We could be talking about regaining possession if the landlord wants to sell it. The counter-argument to that is, well, what does that mean? There's the provision that it has to be on the market and they've given a time frame to put it on the market. But markets can change. You might find that you're not able to sell the property. Does that mean you should be penalised as a result of that? Likewise, you want to repossess it for your own use or for family members' use. It could well be the case with some properties you want to repossess it to put perhaps an elderly relative into it because it might be nearer to your own home, so you could provide care and support for them. It might well be, sadly, that in the process of giving the required notice, which is a considerable number of months, that person might actually have to go into residential care or they might pass away, for instance. So therefore, the intention for which you raised that notice in the first place no longer applies. But it was genuine. And so, again, there could be evidencing issues around these issues. So, but I think it's important that we have them.
Thank you. Ms. Dixon.
Thank you. We also believe the 3 month strike's the right balance. We also need to... I think the fear here is that a landlord would take a 3 month fine on the chin to get rid of a bad tenant. However, you have to remember that a 3 month fine wouldn't be the end of a sanction for a tenant. The risk for a landlord, would be that the landlord registration could be evoked. They would not repeatedly use this because they would lose their whole business and it would not be worth it. The other point to make is there actually wouldn't be any reason for people to wrongfully evict, apart from possibly the circumstances John has covered, which I don't think should count as wrongful eviction. If the grounds are watertight, they'll use the grounds. They won't need to think, I've got a real reason to get rid of one. What ground can I fit it into? It might not fit well. They'll just use the appropriate ground and it'll be no reason to wrongfully evict people.
Okay. I'd like us to move on, but we are tight for time. Okay. David Stewart's going to take us through the issue of rent pressure zones. So I want time to address that. David.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested in the witnesses' views on the rent pressure zone proposals on the bill. Is there evidence of excessive rent increases throughout Scotland? Witnesses, I'm sure, will be well aware that from our evidence session last week that the proposals are that local authorities must make the application to Scottish Government Under affirmative procedure, they will grant or otherwise the application. It's normally for a five-year period. There's no minimum or maximum size. So it could be, for example, an estate, a village, a town, a city, or indeed the whole of the local authority area. And the other issue is that if it is granted, then the rent increase would be CPI plus 1%. And witnesses will probably know that the current rate of CPI is minus 0.1% at the current rate. And just to add on the final element at this stage, there was some debate about the index, because ironically CPI doesn't cover housing costs, which seems a little bit odd, and the RPI is a much better index if you're just looking at purely housing costs. So there's quite a lot of meat there, but I think it's a very interesting area, so I'll be grateful for witnesses' views.
Mr. Gordon, then Mr. Warwick.
So the most important thing to remember is that the rental market is a market. It's primarily based on getting a return and a yield on your investment in the property. Whenever we consider the rent for a property, the first thing we do is we look at what the yield would be if you calculate it somewhere between 4 and 6%. And very often that is what the rental is, even when in areas where people think the rents have soared, that's because the property value has soared. So what the government should be doing is tackling housing prices, and that would control rent prices. So if you tackle rent prices, then you completely skew the market in housing altogether. And our view is that as surveyors, that doesn't really make any sense. So when we're doing home reports, I don't do home reports, but when surveyors are doing home reports, they're looking very carefully at the comparable evidence in the market. They have to put in a rental figure, and they have to consider what the local markets are and the market rents are, but they also have to think about the yield on the property. And by having any restrictions on rent, that can have an impact on that. The second problem with it in terms of the rent control zones is that, there's two problems with that. One is that it provides a definite level of uncertainty for all investors, because they will not know what's going to happen, whether a council is going to suddenly decide to try and introduce one. And that's probably the biggest thing that's going to put off individual and institutional investors, is that uncertainty. So investors, particularly at the corporate level, are just not going to look at it if that comes in certain areas. And so, as I said, we speak directly to a small number of investors, but I'm sure that Dr. Boyle speaks directly to many more, where they're just saying that if this actually is enacted as it is, then they will not invest here. They may well come back and consider it again when things change or markets change again, but as it stands, they can invest elsewhere and they don't need to invest here. The second problem in that rent pressure zones is that there's no way of defining what's happening with rent. So it's all about existing tenancies and raising rents on those. So all the headlines are about advertised rents. So we advertise all our properties on Rightmove or Zoopla. That data is publicly available, but nobody knows what I increased the rents on in my existing stock on the existing tenants. And I can tell you that we assessed all the rents this year in all our properties, and we wrote to about 30% of our landlords where we thought the rent had fallen behind the market. And there was only one landlord who wanted to increase the rent. We caveated every email saying that, of course, this is a good tenant who's staying, they're not causing any problems, the inspections are good, you might want to consider not increasing the rent, but this is what the market's done. And none of them wanted to increase the rent, apart from one. And that was only by a very marginal amount, because they wanted to try and keep pace with their other costs. So there's a danger that you're going to change the market again in ways that doesn't suit the tenant either.
Thank you. Mr. Warwick.
Briefly, I think that rent pressure zones are a poor idea. If one looks at what has happened in the booming oil market or the market in Aberdeen in the last few years, you know, market forces have actually corrected that probably more quickly than actually any activity in rent pressure zone. To pick up a little bit on what Mr. Gordon has said, and I think Dr. Boyle is probably the best one to answer this, I think, and I mentioned earlier on the student market, there is a real shortage of data relating to real facts and figures about what's happening in the marketplace. And I'd really encourage everybody here to come together with a view to actually bringing together data. Within my office, I have an internal system which actually takes the information from the energy performance certificate, which every advertised property has, which has got the floor area on it, and the energy efficiency rating, and we then calculate a rent per square foot per square meter per month, and we can analyse on a street-by-street basis what is actually happening to all the rents in our portfolio. Now, that takes a bit of working on, and nationally it would take quite a bit, but we need to get something like that so we've got hard and fast figures. And finally, the solution to a lot of this is actually the supply of property. If we get the supply coming into the marketplace, kind of things will be...
Dr. Boyle.
Yeah, I do this kind of thing for a living, but if you put me up against the wall and says, what's the average rent achieved in Scotland today, I'd have to be honest with you and say, I don't know. I think it's somewhere between around about £500 and £750 per calendar month, but it entirely depends on what index that that you're looking at. All of the methodologies and all of the indices have their different strengths and weaknesses, but there is no definitive rental index in Scotland that tells you at any one time what's happening with rents anywhere in the country or by property type. In Ireland, they've got a private residential tenancies board that does track every single rent, a bit like the Register of Scotland tracks every single house sale. It tracks every single rent in the country. So Ireland's got a definitive database of rents and how they're changing in a way that we don't. So there is a complete, well, not a complete lack of data, but there is a serious holes in the data sets that we have to try and decipher what's happening with rent movements. The evidence is mixed, but the bulk of the evidence would seem to suggest that rents have not been rising above inflation anywhere over a period of time. Take it back to 2008, 9 or 10. In fact, nominal rents, not even adjusting for inflation, but nominal rents in Scotland fell between 2008 and 2011. Once you adjust for inflation, there's only one place in Scotland where they were markedly above inflation, but only for a short time, and they're now coming down, and that was Aberdeen. And that's because you had a bubble both in the house prices and with the oil price. And you had incomes rising as well, which caused rents to rise in that particular part of the world. Whether you used RPI or CPI is an interesting question. The advantage of using RPI would be that it does take account of housing costs. The disadvantage is it's no longer an officially designated statistic by the ONS, although they do still report on it. But if you were looking for some kind of inflation measure, I would have thought you would have had to look for one that does incorporate housing costs in some way, and that's well worth exploring, I think, in further detail with the ONS. Just to reiterate Mr. Warwick's point, what rent rises do is it's a signal to the market to increase supply. But once you've got a rent control in there that depresses the rent below the market level, it's fairly basic economics, you get a reduction in supply. And places like San Francisco and Stockholm in Sweden, where this has happened, that's what you've got. And in Stockholm now, if you want to rent rent a flat in the city centre, your letting agent will tell you come back in 10 years because that's the size of the waiting list. If you're happy enough to go to the suburbs, you'll only have to wait about 7 years. For the investment or the investor market, it's probably, as I said earlier, it's going to be seen as the thin end of the wedge, and we'll see make Scotland appear less attractive than other parts of the British Isles for this type of investment, particularly build to rent, which is a potential game changer in getting new supply going in this country. It's interesting, going back to the Ireland example again, that in Ireland, as I said, they collect very accurate rental data. In Dublin over the last year, rents have gone up 10% on average. I mean, that's marked. And Ireland thought very closely about introducing rent controls, but backed off. because they were worried about the impact on supply. They rode back pretty much at the last minute. I would only make one final point. There was a Movers and Shakers conference which I attended, and there was a number of other people here who were at that a couple of weeks ago in Edinburgh. And that was to bring together all the investors, the developers, the housing associations, government. The housing minister made an announcement on the new bill and its measures at that conference. I would ask people to go and look at the list of attendees at that conference. There were very few of the big actual investors and funds present. The following week, they had a similar conference down south. They were all there. And I think that shows where Scotland is now on the radar for this type of investment.
Okay, David.
I think that's very interesting, the points made by Dr. Boyle. But if I could just read into the record the information we got from SPICE, our independent information service, have looked at the government publications, and they looked at figures between 2014 and 15, and the annual change in average private rents by property size was 1.6 for a one-bedroom, up to 3% for a one-bedroom shared property, to 2.8 for a three-bedroom. But the crucial point, I think, and Dr. Wells touched on this, is the regional disparities. And as you would expect, Greater Glasgow, Lothian and West Lothian are sort of top of the league. And because of the difficulties with oil price, particularly Aberdeen, Aberdeenshire, has fallen quite dramatically. But one interesting point from Mount McKenzie in my own area is Argyll and Bute has actually shot up, quite surprisingly. They've gone up to sort of mid-table. So the regional disparities are really quite interesting. These figures in terms of annual increases are quite useful as well. But the key point I think I made is that we've effectively got a deflationary position in terms of CPI currently, so you've got to bear that in mind when you look at these comparisons.
The briefing was very good.
Okay, David, and then, Mr. Cox and then Mr. Blackwood.
I would actually agree with a lot of what has already been said in terms of the investment, where there is rent control in one part, in a small part of the country, and a small part of one country. Investors, be they landlords or institutions, will look for somewhere else to invest. I would also agree that CPI doesn't take into account cost of housing. With the changes to RPI, I know the Valuation Office Agency at the moment are in the final stages of creating CPI-H, CPI plus housing, which they are hoping will become the new measure, the new national measure of inflation. So I would suggest that as you're going through the bill, do speak to the Valuation Office Agency and see whether that would be a more appropriate barometer. But really, one of our main concerns is that rents go up generally in line with house prices, and the problem with that situation at the moment is that we just do not have enough house building in this country. If you artificially impose controls on rent prices, one, investors will go elsewhere, but those that remain will be much more selective about which tenants they take, as has already been raised in response to the rent arrears section. And therefore, when we've got increasing demand in places like Edinburgh and Glasgow, meeting stagnating supply, where are the people, one, supposed to live? And when demand increases, what we're going to have is agents and landlords being much, much more selective in who they take, and therefore low-income people, people who have had homelessness issues, that have had antisocial behaviour issues, that have had rent arrear issues, are highly unlikely to actually ever be able to secure a good quality tenancy, which means the people that this bill is designed to help and these provisions are designed to help is actually going to hurt them the most. And they will be the ones that will be unfortunately pushed into the hands of the rogue operators and the criminal operators at the very bottom of the sector. And therefore, the very aims of the provisions relating to this will have exactly the opposite effect.
Yeah, Mr. Blackwood.
Just concurring, convener, with a lot that's already been said, but importantly, we're talking about supply and demand. It's market forces. If we have a shortage in housing, then you're going to pay more for it. So therefore, that can result in rents increasing. It's important to acknowledge we are talking about official government statistics or ONS statistics, talking about 1.6 as an average increase across Scotland, which is much less than what it is in other parts of the UK. So that doesn't seem to indicate that, we do have an overall problem here, albeit we'll have regional variations. Scottish Government in its second consultation on the bill actually recognised that heavy-handed regulation of sectors, even locally, can have an adverse effect on the marketplace. It actually says heavy-handed regulation of rents could jeopardise efforts to improve affordability through increasing supply by discouraging much-needed investment. And I think we have to be very careful about that and not frighting off investors here in Scotland.
Okay, Mr. Gordon.
Yeah, just a point I've been thinking about as people are talking is that it's almost like it's too simplistic, rent control. So if you think about economics or any kind of supply and demand, then if you're considering rents, then you must consider the capital value or the cost of running that property. So if the Bank of England puts interest rates up to 5% and everybody's got their buy-to-let mortgages and their mortgages are shooting up, and then they're not allowed to increase prices on the rent on their property, well, they're going to go bust. If you compare it to any other market, it just wouldn't work. So milk prices are supposed to be too low at the moment, which they probably are for farmers, but you know, if the price of wheat doubles, then the cost of the milk going to the supply chain has to go up. So if the cost of supplying a property to the to the rental market goes up, then the price has to be adjusted. So you need to tackle the source of the problem rather than try and tackle the outcome, which is rents rising. And there isn't evidence that rents have risen too much. As Dr. Boyle said, there were a number of years in Edinburgh when I was working where rents weren't really rising at all, even when property prices were actually rising. So some of the recent rental increases in Edinburgh have actually just been catching up with that underlying yield of between 4 and 6% gross yield. So there isn't evidence for the requirement for rent controls. What there is evidence for is the requirement for more housing.
Okay, David.
Thank you, Convener. The committee also took some evidence to suggest that rent pressure zones should be interim measure until further research is carried out into different models of rent control and their potential effects. Do you agree? And I suppose we should look at best practice as well. If you take an analogy, I think it's in the Netherlands where rent increases are linked to quality. So if you increase the facilities in the flat or the house that you've got, there'd be links there to increasing rent. What do the witnesses, how do the witnesses feel about these points?
Dr. Boyle.
Yeah, just quickly, Convener, thanks. Cath Scanlon probably is the best source for international evidence on rent control. She's at the LSE, she's written widely on the subject. She made a very good point at a shelter conference, actually, that there is a real danger in cherry-picking an aspect of a country's housing market policy, assuming that you can drop it in to your own housing market and for it to have a kind of a benign or even positive impact. Germany does have rent controls, but it's interesting that rents in Berlin have gone up far faster than they have in Edinburgh over the last few years. I mean, far faster, markedly different. They've almost got a kind of a benchmarking approach to setting rent levels. But both Germany and the Netherlands and a number of other countries that have rent controls have had this system or this housing market system for a very long period of time. So everyone's had time to kind of get used to it and adapt to it, both investors, landlords, and tenants. What they also have, which we don't have here, is the incentive packages to landlords in the sector are far greater than they are here. In Germany, for example, rent losses can be offset against other income in your tax returns. They also have a planning and a legislative system that promotes housing supply. So in Munich, they build around about 5 units per every 100,000. In most of the main Scottish cities at the moment, it's about 2.5. So if you combine measures to increase supply, greater incentives for landlords and a system, an institutionalised housing system that's been around for 30 to 40 years, then yes, rent controls might work. But I would think you would have to have all of those combinations of measures in place.
David.
Final point, conveners. The proposals for rent pressure zones only apply to sitting tenants, but there's been some suggestion that should also apply to new tenancies as well. What can I ask the witnesses what their views on these proposals are?
Mr. Blackwood.
My understanding from the proposals within the bill is about offering predictability of rents and not controlling rents, and that's been very clear from the Scottish Government, and I think that's probably a wise move in the sense of you don't want to deter potential investment in the future by controlling any market, even though this is still controlled by the back door. So it's important to emphasise that and recognise that. So what we're looking at is creating communities where tenants in the private rental sector can have security of tenure once in a tenancy and predictability of their rent levels in the future. And I think that's the most appropriate way to deal with it rather than actually tackling the market itself. The only downside of this is, of course, it's all very well having predictability in potentially what your rent could go up in rent pressure zones. The market is completely without that control, which is partly the point that's been made. So if you're a tenant in one of those tenancies, whilst you've got protection of predictability and security of tenure, then to move on to another similar property in that given area might be more difficult for you because you might not be able to afford it. And hence, that's why we have these issues in comparable areas in other parts of the world as well, too, where they have introduced similar rent controls.
Okay, thank you.
Thank
Can
you.
I turn to the issue, if witnesses have no further comments on that, and the issue of rent pressure zones? Fine. The issue of rent increases and the provisions in the bill to challenge a rent increase. Section 19 of the bill provides that a landlord may increase the rent payable under the tenancy by giving the tenant a rent increase notice, with the minimum notice period proposed being 3 months. Section 17 of the bill provides that the landlord cannot increase the rent more than once in a 12-month period. This is a question more for Mr. Cox. Your evidence, or your organisation's evidence, suggests a shorter notice period than 3 months for rent increases. So I'm interested in knowing the justification for that and what real benefit this would provide to the landlords, particularly as in practice some landlords only increase their rents at the end of the tenancy.
Exactly. One of our concerns was when considering Section 17, Clause 17, that it can only be once every 12 months. Having to have a 3-month notice period effectively means that you have to calculate what the rent is going to be 3/4 of the way through a tenancy, at which point, particularly in light of the ability to go to the rent officers and the appeals to the first tier tribunals after that, if the tenant disagrees with what the rent will be, you know, we don't know, as we've talked about, the markets do change quite regularly. 3 months is a long period of time to say, well, your rent will go up by X in 3 months' time. If the market suddenly changes for one reason or another during that time, or the market doesn't move as fast as the agent or the landlord expects it to, that would actually open up the landlord through no fault of their own, merely trying to predict what the market will do at a point in the future, to complaints to the rent officers and first-tier tribunal. So we would shorten it to either 1 month or 2 months, okay. But would recommend 1 month.
Okay. Mr. Gordon.
I don't think we had a strong opinion against that. I think overall we felt it was sensible to have just a clear understanding for everybody what can and can't happen. So that brings it into line with commercial leases. Actually, that you would know when the rent reviews are going to be and when that would happen. I think I can see the argument for what the difficulty in thinking 3 months ahead, but I personally didn't have an issue with that. I just think it's quite a good idea for tenants to know and be able to plan for what they're having to do in their budgets as far as possible in advance.
Thank you very much. Ms. Dixon.
We supported what's drafted as well. The majority of our members don't review rents more than once per year anyway, so that fits in with what they already do. We also think that it's...
So you're happy with the 3 months then?
We're happy with the three months. We don't see a problem with having to give tenants more notice.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to another issue in that case. Succession following the death of a tenant. Section 54 of the bill provides that a private residential tenancy is not terminated by the death of the sole tenant. And Section 55 sets out that if the deceased tenant leaves behind a partner who has occupied the let property as his or her only or principal home, then the partner can inherit the tenancy subject to specific criteria being met. What do witnesses think of that? And Mr. Blackwood, did you want to?
Yes, certainly with regards to Section 56, this was a concern for us with regards to the security of tenure continuing after physical death of the tenant. Obviously, there's practical implications here for us, and as a landlord myself, sadly, I've come across this situation where we've had to deal with a tenant who's sadly passed away, who has no relatives, who has no estate, who has no will. And there's a requirement here for the executor to give notice to the landlord. In that scenario, there was no executor, and the only way of getting one would be by asking the court to appoint an executor, which is a bit pointless if there is no estate and, of course, resultantly no will from that. What we need to do is, in a way, help support the moving on of that tenancy from the physical death of the tenant there. This is obviously assuming there's no succession by partners, obviously, so a tenant living on their own, to enable that property to get back in the marketplace and for somebody else to move into it. We feel the proposal is inequitable, and basically there should be a similar proposal to social housing. Why should it be different to in the private rented sector?
Ms. Dixon?
We don't have a problem with succession to a partner. We think it's reasonable under most circumstances. We'd like to see it restricted to one succession, such as it already is in the 1988 Act. We think that the continuation brings a complication, though. As we've already discussed, what if there's no executor? What if notice isn't given? What if there's no funds to pay the continuing rent? We also believe that a successor should already be identified. In another clause of the bill, it already says that landlords should be notified if someone's living as a married partner. So the landlord will already know if the partner's there to succeed the tenancy.
Mr. Cox, did you have a view?
I was actually going to support everything that was just being said and, again, raise particularly the issue of tenants that die intestate because it can and will cause significant problems trying to regain possession and get the property back into use.
Okay. Did you want to say anything?
Oh, sorry.
Okay, thank you. Okay, my final question is really if there are any areas that we haven't covered off in our discussion this morning. This is your opportunity now to put those on the record. Ms. Dixon.
I'd just like to bring up two additional grounds that we'd like added onto the list of the current 16. The first one, first of all, I don't think either of these would take away from the security of tenure for tenants. I think they're very reasonable grounds to propose. The first is that in a rural situation, in order for a rural business to grow and develop, it's often necessary to expand your workforce. And a lot of this workforce needs to be sited, to be accommodated on site. We therefore would like to see a ground included that we could ask a family or a current tenant to leave in order to accommodate this new employee. The final one is a more open one, which if we can accept that the no-fault ground has gone, the only other way that we can see to give full safeguard that we've been promised to a landlord is to allow a landlord to take a case to the tribunal for any other reasonable circumstance. Be totally discretionary, but it would give that safeguard that in very unusual circumstances, not necessarily a fault of the tenants, then the landlord could make their case and regain possession of that property.
Okay. Mr. Cox?
I'm fairly some totally different side to that, but I just wanted to raise one additional point as well. It's a minor one, but it's in relation to the statutory terms in Schedule 2, and particularly regarding access. And it says that the landlord will give the tenant at least 48 hours notice that the landlord requires access for the purposes of carrying out work on the let property or inspecting the let property
in order to determine that work, if any, to carry out. In the cases of a broken boiler or something like that, it's not always practical to give 48 hours notice. And I'm sure we've all dealt with plumbers, electricians, tradesmen that say, well, I can come this afternoon, I can go, or I can come next Tuesday. At which point, the landlord or the agent would have to say, we can't come this afternoon, you will have to come in a few days' time because I have to give the tenant at least 48 hours notice. So we would just ask that in that section it is caveated with where practically possible, and we have to take into account the other factors that weigh on a landlord or an agent's ability to actually get somebody into the property to undertake works.
Are there any other comments, Mr. Gordon?
Just on the ground about, so the RSCS agrees that where a business has been renting out a property and then needs to employ somebody who would normally have stayed in that property. So if they're a farm worker and then they didn't need a farm worker anymore, then circumstances changed and they did, they should be able to have a ground similar to the one for religious purposes where they could end the tenancy if they needed it back for a new employee. And the second thing is more of a general point, just in terms of reminding anyone listening that the RICS does not specifically represent landlords' interests. And as the majority of the things that I have worked on in my role for the last few years within the RICS have actually improved protection for tenants and be very specifically focused on things related to the tenant rather than the landlord. So it's important to remember that the landlord bodies that are here as well, I think this applies to them, that they want to have a good sector that works well for everybody. There's always going to be a disagreement over the rent side of things because of whether they believe that the market should be allowed to operate or not. But when it comes to considering what should happen, we all want to see things improved. And it, regardless of how small you think the rogue element is, tackling that rogue element is the important thing rather than tackling everybody. And it's a distraction sometimes to focus on changing things which aren't actually going to help them. The loss of the no-fault ground and the rent control measures will not protect the tenants that shelter and other bodies are concerned about. They will, in my view, personal view, potentially make things worse by reducing the supply in the market.
Okay, anyone else have any final comments? Dr. Boyle, then Mr. Blackwood.
Can I just correct myself from something that I said earlier? I said that the average, the build rate, the average of 2.7 homes built per 1,000 people in Scottish main Scotland's main cities, I think I said 100,000, which would really be an anemic build rate, but it's 2.7 homes built per 1,000 people, and in German cities it's 5 per 1,000 inhabitants. So just to correct that.
Okay, any further corrections or comments, Mr. Blackwood?
What we haven't mentioned already is clause 38.3 talks about an instance where a tenant gives notice to the landlord and they have the right to gives notice to the landlord but then decides that they don't want to leave after all. The landlord has a right to refuse that. However, we're unsure as to what legal ability they would have to be able to regain possession of the property. So we would regard that there needs to be an additional ground there for repossessing the property where the tenants have given prior notice.
Okay. Mr. Warwick.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to go back to the student issue. Just one final comment, which really is that the consumer is at the heart of this bill, and what we're trying to do is we're trying to deliver product for them. And what I'd like to suggest is that in considering how the bill is adjusted, that we think in terms of what do the students want from either university accommodation or private landlord accommodation, and then look at a consistent delivery of accommodation from all those sources.
Okay, anyone else? In that case, Mr. Warwick, you have the final word. Can I thank our witnesses for attending today's session? It's been a long session, but I hope you feel that it's been a productive one. I'm sure that members of the committee feel
feel that it has been. The next meeting of the committee is on the 18th of November. The committee will take further evidence on the Private Housing Tenancy Scotland Bill from council representatives and legal bodies. That concludes today's meeting, and I now close this meeting of the committee. Thank you.